Yuki Nari wakes up to find that the pink-haired girl, Miharu, is now dressed and that his allergic reaction hasn't happened. Miharu asks Yuki Nari if he wants something to eat, revealing that he's from Japan, and Yuki Nari is on a different planet, Seiwen.
So, this is it.
So close and yet so far. It looks like you could reach up and touch it, but no one ever has.
Stop right there. If Seiwen is that close to us, then why has no one on us, like, say, an astronomer at an observatory, noticed a planet that close to them? I mean, news of a tense planet would be big news in itself, but a new planet so close to us, between us and Mars, would be something gigantic and should be spread about immediately.
Okay, I know I've been guilty of this a few times in my reviews, but I still say trying to apply real-world logic to anime doesn't work. I've said it several times, and to be honest, I'm tired of repeating myself on this subject. Now granted, relationship logic usually works the same, but for something like this, especially for an anime that involves some sci-fi, it's an acceptable break from reality.
This really sucks!
Oh, yes. Trapped on an alien planet with a modern society, breathable atmosphere, the biggest scientific discovery of your planet's history, and a girl that doesn't treat you like shit and actually seems interested in you? That is just the worst situation to be in, man!
You know, I've said this of Captain N, and I'm gonna say it here. Just because you're trapped in a world that's more accepting of you doesn't mean you should be able to leave your friends and family behind just like that. I mean, imagine how his family would feel if they couldn't contact him. As far as Yuki Nari knows, there's no way that he can get home now. So yeah, it does suck.
Oh, I'm relieved. You really seem to like the taste of Seiren cooking, Yuki Nari.
But, question. Are you allergic to tribbles?
Okay, that was pretty funny.
That... over there is a plate of fried kimono.
Wow.
They're deep sea.
So there are girls like her. She's shorter than I am. She's really sweet to me. And best of all. Even if she touches me, I don't get my girl rash.
Personally, I'd rather have Mihao be voiced by Hayden Walsh. I don't know why, but it seems more fitting.
Personally, I think Michelle Ruff was doing her best Hayden Walsh impersonation for this role anyway, so I don't think it matters that much.
Oh, I was pretty freaked out earlier, but it's not like there's anything good waiting for me back on Earth, right? Even Kiri is mad at me. Really, Seiren's not so bad.
Why does he get the bathtub with the sweet moe girl? I have a portal in my bathtub, and all leads into a sub-dimension with a bunch of giant demonic worms!
There's a little inconsistency with your jokes here. Earlier you were wondering how the bath portal thing worked, and now you have a bath portal. Yes, I know it's a joke and I shouldn't take it seriously, but it's still not consistent.
Miharu's oldest sister walks in on them, and she likes what she sees, apparently.
Oh, you're such a cutie! Napping on my pillows, huh? It's okay.
And that's twice now I've seen my Valentine's Force voice actress putting the moves on a boy in one of my reviews. Miharu frees Yuki Nari and heads out of the house. Later, Yuki Nari tries to catch his breath for being glomped earlier, but more women start to come on to him, leading to a chase. Miharu now reveals that Seiwen's male population is less than 10%. Even with that revelation, that doesn't really justify this chase scene. Let me explain with some mathematics. For all intents and purposes, let's say Seiwen's population is 6,904,857,807 people. To get 10%, we'll multiply by 0.10, that's decimal 10 in your calculator, rounding to the nearest whole number, and the assumed male population is 690,485,781. Not as much as the former, but still a big enough number for supposed endangered species. A 10-to-1 ratio is not that big. 50-to-1, on the other hand, you can say that the town that Miharu lives in is devoid of men, but that doesn't really justify this chase scene, in my opinion. Like I said, maybe it was a bigger ratio than 10.
You know, the chase scene is there because it's supposed to be funny. Just saying. Also, how do you know Saren's population is the same as Earth's? There's no indication of that. For all we know, Saren may be the size of Pluto.
Anyway, there's a chase scene, and I should put something like, I don't know, the Beatles playing in this scene, but I don't want to besmirch any band's good name. Miharu's sister and the other girls circle around the now unconscious Yukinari, and all these girls caused him to go nuclear.
While that gag was quite funny, that wasn't Yukinari. It was Miharu. It's part of her magic powers that are developed later on in the series.
Yukinari? Yukinari!
Why is he still moving? Naturally, the buildings would have stopped his projection. Instead, we see here he's just randomly running into things with no real reason. I can't even tell if this is supposed to be in real time or just a montage. It's all so random.
First, this scene was meant as a joke. And second, his movement makes perfect sense. First, he was sliding down the side of the building and gravity was pulling him. After that, the water current pushed him along. Makes sense to me.
I can only assume he's being controlled by a voodoo doll or something.
Then the chiefy could fly. Fly, chiefy, fly. Oopsie.
After Yukinari recovered from whatever the hell that was, we have some touching moments between Yukinari and Miharu.
And then I see you there in the middle of it. So you see, you must be a very special boy to me.
Miharu.
Look! Oh. It's happening
Whoa.
Again.
Blue light. Just like... I saw it right before I... Period.
No! I really just wanted to be friends.
Sword? Check. Music? You'll get no sympathy from me.
Don, don't turn into confused Matthew on me. Please. You're a great reviewer, and I don't want you to go down that road.
It started letting me see into your world a little while ago.
I gotta go back.
Why? Why you wanna go back? I mean, yes, the girls are overbearing in this world, but at least it's better than going back to...
Thanks for swapping cleanup shifts with us.
But I didn't...
Huh? Does the puny little dork have a problem with
that? No, of course not. I'm not tall enough to reach the top of the chalkboard.
An underdeveloped physique is no excuse. Just do it again.
If that was all Yukinari's life consisted of, the kid would have committed suicide a long time ago. He still has parents that worry about him, and yes, even if Kyrie has a horrible temper, she still cares about him.
So anyway, Yukinari heads back to us, and Miharu somehow comes with them, and this kind of ruins the moment, or I don't know. I don't care about this ending, I don't want to talk about it! All I want to say at this point is that this anime sucks! The fan service is excessive, the jokes are weak, the premise is outlandish and annoying, and major negative points to Stephanie Shea, one of my favorite voice actresses, for voicing such a vehemently unlikable character.
Again, you assume all this from the first episode. This really makes me wish you'd keep watching and form your opinions then. This is the problem I have with reviewers who only do first impressions. Most of the time, you can't judge a series based on the first few episodes. Now granted, for Don's series, most of the time this works. But this is definitely not one of his strongest episodes. Maybe it's just me, but I really didn't like this one. Well, that's it for this commentary, and wow, look at that! My next commentary will be my 20th one. I wonder who I should do this one on. Irate Gamer, Now, I already said all I have to say on him and Confused Matthew. Man of One title? He's getting better. Hey, what's this? Why The Last Airbender was a great film? Okay, Eli, don't jump to conclusions. Maybe this guy can legitimately defend a bad movie really well. I've seen people do that before, and most of the time it's actually pretty cool to watch. So maybe I should give him a chance.